Hello, everyone, wherever you are. I hope you're having a wonderful week so far. We are here with the latest episode of the Inside Crypto Show, interviews and discussion with regular people like yourselves. Today, we are joined by Tom Basie, the founder of Basie Insurance and a bunch of other stuff. We're going to talk about some of that today, whatever we have time for. I have to do the usual disclaimer. Anything said by either Tom or myself does not constitute financial advice. Our opinions are our own and not to be connected with our employers or organizations. Please do your own research. Because it's just Tom today, we're going to talk about his background a little bit before we dive into today's questions. Tom, welcome to the show. Thank you for making time today. I appreciate it. Why don't you tell our audience and our listeners and our viewers a little bit about yourself?
Certainly. Number one, thanks for having me on. It's good to be here. So my undergraduate, believe it or not, is actually mechanical engineering. I worked for many years in corporate America. Really, I made a transition. I did an MBA part-time while I was working. And so I worked as a design engineer and I worked as a project manager. And all of my undergraduate was mechanical. I actually did a lot of software development projects. I spent over 15 years in telecom, big software, enterprise-wide software solutions sometimes. And I actually made a transition later. I'd spent almost 7 years in medical device. So I've got a diverse kind of product development technology background. And then, like I say, education is engineering and then master's in business. But I made a career transition 4 years ago. I became an independent insurance broker. I also, while I was doing that other stuff, I dabbled, as everybody has to own their own personal finance. So I read personal finance and used personal financial products. So actually 4 years ago now, I've stepped in, I've walked away from corporate America and it's become entrepreneurial. And so I just, all day now, I have conversations just helping people on their own personal financial journeys. So that's kind of me in a synopsis. I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Nice. No, that's a wonderful synopsis. There's so much interesting stuff for our audience. Like, Tom is here for a short time, so that's how we're sort of speeding through things compared to what we usually do on this show. So Tom, you are doing a bunch of cool things, and most of our audience here is for crypto, a little bit of personal finance. And just like literally a few minutes ago, you told me about something about Dojaga. Why don't you fill us in on what that is?
So for one thing, we are all largely finding our way in Web3, blockchain, and that kind of stuff. So myself and my partner, we've done it for a while now. So yes, we have both custodial and non-custodial wallets. We hold, purchase, and select cryptocurrencies. We have NFTs. We've actually helped somebody. There's a project. I didn't stick that in there for you. It's saying I got a lot of stuff going on. We've actually helped an artist produce some NFTs and push them to the blockchain, that kind of stuff. So we're a consultancy, if you will, at this point. We're trying to figure out exactly how we're going to participate. So we've done a lot of stuff and we help a lot of people. So dojaga.io is, that's how they can reach out to us. But we're still trying to figure out exactly what we're doing. We're just looking for projects. So that's why I wanted to come on today. I'm just looking for collaborators. Hey, let's sit down and talk about stuff. So that's what we do. We help onboard or ramp on people, neophytes who are more neophytes than ourselves. Everybody has almost less than 10 years experience. Right? There's a few old G's, right? As a general, we're all just learning together. So that's what Dojaga is, to help people. We have some insight into technology, certain types of technology and certain processes. I find that when we help that artist generate a bunch of NFTs and push them to the blockchain, it's one thing to have a auto-generate code and generate a bunch of variations of a single image. But if you have individual things, I use something I call the NFT factory. So we help them develop a process where you can reproducibly do that with quality and reproducible and that kind of thing. So exactly what we do, it's hard to say, right? If you want to see the roadmap in somebody's NFT project, it's being written, or we're fixing the plane while we're flying. But that's a little intro there to Dojaga.
Okay. A question to follow up on that. Like you said, talking about the artists and NFTs, like what blockchain did you use for those NFTs? Because there's so many choices. Did you suggest to the artist, or do you have something that you prefer yourself?
So here's the thing. You issue the disclaimer. I try to. Sometimes you can't help it if you're in love with something. What I would offer is, that's the thing. We looked at a couple of different blockchain options and then really the distribution center. So there's certain obvious ones, but to me, that's the thing. An artist doesn't know what a blockchain is. They don't understand a header and a block. And so we talk through that. And then layer one versus layer two, that's the nature of the consultant. We help them understand those and help them make the decision based on what they want to accomplish, for example. And so we did pick a particular one. So I'll say this. We wanted lower gas fees, and so we found one that was economical for them and purchased. And then there's an exchange for the NFTs, kind of talk through them. Consider which wallet, which exchange. And so we just help them do that. And whatever, I want this conversation between you and I to be timeless. So I'd rather say it generically. That way it's still true in a year from now. Whatever I said, that guy didn't know something. Well, no, that's still true. The truth is, you should consider the entire solution. What is it you want to accomplish? And consider all those different factors, be it which blockchain, the layer, the exchange, all that kind of stuff.
And why did the artist approach you? Like how did he say, okay, Tom Basie's the guy to solve my problem?
Candidly, in a certain way, that again, this is not unlike everything. It's ad hoc. Actually, he's a childhood friend of mine anyway. And he's been an artist in a variety of forms, and he's a successfully commercial artist. In fact, he did the logo for one of my companies. So he and I were already engaged in business anyway. And then when the NFT thing came up, it fell out of conversations. So I don't hold as much NFT as one of my partners. He holds more. That's the thing, we collaborate together. So childhood friend who happens to be an artist, a technology guy like me who happens to have a small company with people who do more NFT trading than I do. But I understand blockchains and I understand network and that kind of stuff. So it was organic.
Okay, that's very cool. And Tom, for our listeners, like, how did you get into blockchain and cryptocurrency? Was it just a love of technology? What was that sort of first memory of yours?
So I love technology, but candidly, it really did come out of traditional finance. In other words, for many years, there's certain things that I'll assume a lot of your audience knows, like the time value of money and compound interest, even maybe things like dollar cost averaging that I had long done anyway. I have a son, I only have one, and I got him into stocks early on. When he was in elementary school, he purchased Apple, 20 something years ago. And so, well, part of the problem is he thinks everything you buy automatically goes up, never comes down kind of thing. That's not exactly, but my point is, so it was actually my son that got involved first. So he got it on my radar. And so I believe in, and that's saying these are universal truths. I believe in things like diversification and researching your investments. And so I'm not a speculation guy. I like to understand what I'm investing. I like to be deliberate about it. And so he put on radar, and because I'm old and he's like, you go ahead and invest in that, I won't. He did very well in it. And so again, these are organic things, but that's the way it happened. So my approach initially was really finance and investing and something. I'm interested in things that are going to grow. But to your point, actually, at the end of the day, I knew I was going to be an engineer when I was in second grade. So yes, I have a lifelong love of technology. And disclaimer, I left certain parts of corporate America because I don't like the negative impact of technology. Yes, there's some negative things. You can make that argument for any kind of technology. Anything can have a positive or negative effect the way humans use it. But I don't like the dehumanization that sometimes technology has. What we're doing right now, you and I are not in the same room, but we're having a nice conversation. It's a pleasure to visit with you today, and your listeners get here. So I like those aspects of it. So yes, I love technology. I think it's inevitable. And it was my understanding of the internet, for example. In one form or another, I think things are going to be this way. Networks are going to be distributed. There's certain benefits to it. There's pros and cons in any solution, but it's just clear to me this is the way it's going. So long answer for that, but I hope that suffices.
Yeah, that's perfect. No problem. Lots of stuff has been happening like the last 2 to 3 weeks in cryptocurrency. So we're going to take a step back from crypto and talk about like macroeconomics. The Fed raised the rates by 75 basis points yesterday. And given your wealth of experience, I'm so glad you're here. It's like literally the perfect time. What's your take on the rate hike, the effect on Americans, the effect on the global economy? How do you feel about that?
It's a little unflattering that I know this because I am old enough that I've lived a couple of these cycles. And so that's the thing. I do consider it cyclical. Now, there are some distinctions between this. Some of the drivers, we've had wars before that have negative impact. We've had significant, but that's then there's some historic changes to the Fed. So they're trying to control things. At the end of the day, it's not good. It's not fun. People are suffering for it. Having said that, I do think it is cyclical. I think there are things that will come out of it. And that's always been my approach. That's the thing. Sometimes people don't like to hear this, but in other words, whether you look at the old standard of the S&P 500 and you look at that, things do go up and down. And so it is bad right now, but I think a variety of different things, be it government, global economic things that are going to change, I think that we're going to come out of it. Yeah, it's not fun right now and it's suffering. And that's the thing, if you don't know what you're doing, it can be a challenging. Again, I don't like to live in cliches, but cliches are often based on good, reasonable things. And so like the last big market crash that was here in 2008, people who wrote it out and or didn't cash out, they ended up actually making money that year. It's a big downward thing and it's unpleasant. Certainly if you sell off now, yeah, you're in bad shape. So I'm a proponent of holding these things and writing them out. And let me clarify, my approach to cryptocurrency, blockchain is still kind of the same thing. I believe, like I say, in diversification. And yeah, let me stop right there. So at an aggregate level, it's bad. Personally, my gut feel is we're towards the bottom of it. I think it's going to be turning around now. And obviously everybody hopes it's going to be turning out. So I think, but I'm bullish on the future. The time horizon is the challenge on it.
Okay. And I definitely agree with that. I think lots of people have suggested different time frames, 3 to 6 months, 2 years, who knows? So Tom, as you said, you've lived through a few of these cycles. For people, we've had so many people. I remember seeing a graph like millions of people around the world have come into cryptocurrency 2021 into 2022 as well. Even some people now with the market the way it is, people are like, okay, now is my chance to get in. How do you suggest for people to survive this crypto winter? Not even for crypto, like how do you suggest for people to endure this poor economic cycle?
And I think that's a great question. I think everybody, and to your point, it applies in either. Number one, you're right. All different people are jumping in and it's great and it helps. The more people that participate, it's good in a certain way. Having said that, I do think a philosophical approach, I think people need to recognize it. It's people who jumped in and thought, this is hot and I'm going to jump in and make a bunch of money. In other words, that's speculation. I don't approve of that. And sometimes it works out and I love it when it does. I'm more about having a reason. And so what I would offer you is this. Here's another thing. Here's another unique, this may be an inflection point or a point of singularity. Blockchain has fundamental implications to finance. I use blockchain and Web3 as I approach it from an engineering standpoint. How about this? DeFi, decentralized finance. Everything these days that is largely not centralized, it's held in one place. And there's some benefits to that. There's some economy of scale, but there's also too much control sometimes in one reason. So my point is, I believe that now that humans have figured out how to do this decentralization, it actually is going to fix certain problems. And so, for example, inflation, there's a variety of reasons that drive it. One of the things is supply. In other words, if we have more dollars available, then the value of the dollar is going to drop down. That's one thing. Decentralization allows people, it solves several economic problems. There's also a billion-dollar industry in foreign exchange. To me, that's an inefficient market. Why is there a $1 billion industry? Can't we do that more efficiently? So as this engineer, I'm enamored and convinced that long-term blockchain and decentralized networks are how everything's going to migrate because of the benefits. They're not perfect either, but that's the thing. It's decentralized. To me, that's more safe and robust. The central point of failure, there is not one, right? There's millions of nodes. So people are incentivized for it to do well. And so I just like it. And so my message to everybody is understand more. And that when I say that, understand more than what an NFT is, understand more than what a cryptocurrency is. Those are two use cases of blockchain and Web3 that I do think it's obvious. How about this? Here's an analogy. We don't have time to cover everything, right? But IoT, I think in other words, everything's going to be connected eventually, and that there's implications to that, economic and it's societal things. And so I think that's why my long-term look is bullish. And what I'm hinting at is, in a certain way, if nothing else, I'm actually more bullish on Web3 than traditional finance because I perceive that as the future.
Okay. Yeah, IoT, for people who don't know, is like the Internet of Things. Yes.
Yeah, sorry.
No worries. We have a few non-English speakers who listen to this as well. Another question I wanted to ask you, Tom, as well. So like you've talked about cryptocurrency as well, and you touched on a very good point, is that people should learn more than what is cryptocurrency, more than what is an NFT. And you're obviously very educated, very experienced, and people can hear that from today's sort of conversation. But how did you learn? What are suggestions for people to learn? Like, what are good sources of information? Because there's so much noise in 2022, YouTube, TikTok, Twitter, whatever it is. Like, what is a good place for people?
That may be the best question you ask all year. And I don't claim to know all the answers, but that's so important. In other words, one, I'm convinced that everybody should be a lifetime learning, even as far as health and wellness. People should be lifelong learning. How and where you do that, that's a challenging. So number one, so I had to pivot when COVID, so although I'm very comfortable, I've had video conferencing for 20 or 30 years as a project manager doing global projects. So that this portion isn't new to me, but I had to learn things. So I've actually started listening only the last couple of years or two on the podcast. Podcasts are a great, and I didn't know it. So you can learn so much and it's still convenient. I'm learning every day while I'm at the gym. So not only am I lifting weights, I'm learning something. So podcasts, traditional reading, whatever you can find. And then here's the one plug I will give because it's so impactful to me. For one thing, I did engineering as my undergraduate. There's a publisher called Wiley. And so, that's law to me if it's published. You know, my thermodynamics book or my mechanics to solve, whatever. Wiley is law. And so I found a book. It was endorsed to me by a professor of economics at a local university for me. And he said, because I asked him, what's the one book? I've read three or four, but I wanted to get that one book. So I kind of had the same question. This guy is an economics professor. And actually, so he wrote this book. He doesn't get to the blockchain and going into crypto until the last two or three chapters. He educated me so much, even though I have an MBA, I didn't understand certain aspects of, for example, the gold market or actually even antiquity, right? How primitive nations would use shells exchange and that kind of stuff. And so I learned so much I learned economics and politics before I then even learned in a relatively small book. And so I'm going to plug that thing because this guy's a visiting professor and the book is The Bitcoin Standard. I'm a big proponent of that thing. So I love that book. So if you're going to read one book, read that thing, The Bitcoin Standard. And I'm not necessarily saying I'm not a Bitcoin bull that only Bitcoin does it. Now, I like it and I'm bullish on it. And I own Bitcoin, but I don't think it's the only, but I love it. And that's the book that I endorse.
Yeah, I've actually seen the cover of that. I think I'm sure I've heard a few people mention it. So I will make sure to include that in the show notes for today as well.
Please, maybe he'll give me some additional copies. The author's name escapes me, unfortunately, but I'm connected with him on LinkedIn and has podcasts, so he's both active. But he's an economics prof and he wrote this book. I love it.
Okay. Tom, so another quick question is, what kind of crypto trader are you? Are you one of those people, are you checking every day? Are you NFT trading every day? I mean, what's your weekly crypto sort of schedule?
I'd like to talk about that a little bit. Now, I'm not necessarily, I'll just answer the question. So the thing is, I believe, so again, I take some of my legacy finance knowledge and apply it to this. And so I don't want to stay up at night worrying about things. So I am aware of it. It's on my phone. I can look at it, but I just don't worry about it. And so I have both custodial and non-custodial wallets. I own multiple different cryptocurrencies and different NFTs. But when I own those, I'm not doing it. I'm not a trader. In other words, so I trade maybe monthly and I put in some more money than this past month when it's down. And so that's the thing. I'm going to say one legacy financial thing, dollar cost averaging. So if you take $100 or $1,000, whatever it is, if you're putting that in each month, well, when it's down, you're buying more of those. And when it's up, you're not buying as many. So that's an example that I'm a proponent of. So I use legacy financial approaches to these new things. And a lot of it's philosophical. And as I think it's evident, I'm so bullish on this. I don't care if it goes way down. I'm convinced it's going up eventually. Now, does that mean every single coin? Perhaps not. That's why it's back to you take a look at it and decide, understand how they work. What are the value of it? Try to avoid rug pulls. There's a lot of analogies that happen that these things are not new. There's nothing new under the sun. That is a lot. The technology is new, but the way it functions in society are still the same.
And I totally agree with that. And you make a very good point. Like going back to your point about education and understanding, right? What is a rug pull? What is not a rug pull? What's there? The long-term prospects as well. It's not, like you said, just a speculative instrument as well. Because we've got just a few minutes left as well, I do want to ask you something because you do so many things, right? Like Dojerga, Tambesi Insurance, and you're also an agent for World Financial Group, if I'm saying that correctly. Most people, as they're getting on in life, they're like, I want to slow down. Why are you speeding up?
Well, on the contrary, great question. So that's the thing. I spent 30 years in corporate America. Actually, corporate America is great and I've benefited from a lot of ways, but there's a lot of pressure on that. And then you're doing what the organization goals have and that kind of stuff. So I became an entrepreneur to allow myself to, so I decide what I want to do. So I had an hour commute one way. I no longer do that. I get to set my hours. Largely, I don't like to work on the weekends. I don't like to be working the evenings. I work largely during the day. There is actually, you say that I have more freedom now. And so I love these things. And the other thing is I'm helping people. When I worked on medical devices, for example, I was helping people, but I get to really, and really it's evident, right? I'm a talker. I love just sitting around and talking about stuff. So if I can sit with somebody and talk and provide some solution, helps them, then that's great. So actually I claim contrary to your remarks, I've actually been able to slow down and, or at least I've reduced stress. My approach now is reduce stress, make decisions that will reduce stress. That means that they have to be sound decisions and clever, but I don't want to stress over them. So that's my remark to that. Actually, I think helping people in financial guidance is one of the things I do. And I'm not doing in blockchain. I'm not doing that. I'm providing consultancy. I'll help people set up things. We'll help them set up what will help them fund that. They make the decision. Even on the artist thing, I talked to you about how we provide information on blockchain, let them choose. So really, instead of being an insurance salesman, some people might label me an insurance salesman and they wouldn't necessarily be inaccurate from a traditional standpoint, but actually on the contrary, I consider myself an educator instead. I merely educate and I let the person decide, because if I talk you into something, you may not be satisfied. You never do it again. If I share the information and you like it and you feel good about it, then you'll endorse me to somebody else too. So that's my approach there.
That's a good approach as well. I know you're running out of time, Tom. So last words you want to give our audience, last things, anything you want to plug, pearls of wisdom to sort of round out today's podcast.
Reach out to me, connect to me on social media. I'm a lot of the different platforms. I'm there. So find Tom Basie and or Basie Insurance and or Dojerga. If you're particularly for Web3 blockchain stuff, please find Dojerga.io and let's just connect. I've enjoyed the conversation. I'd love you to have me on some other time. We'll figure out more things to talk about. Please do have me on again.
For sure. Definitely. You've said so much interesting stuff today and had to control myself to stop from asking more questions. So I appreciate it.
Me too.
And thank you very much, Tom. And I've got a lot of your social media as well, so I'll put that in the show notes today. If you guys are interested in connecting with Tom, please do that through social media. And then we'll try and connect sometime a bit later in the year.
Wonderful. Thanks very much. You have a good rest of your day.
You too, Tom. Take care. Bye.